there's like an audio delay from us to him, as well as a video delay back from him to us. So.
Oh, come on, Isaiah. But come on. Cool. I need the...
Oh, the... I don't think any of that went into his mouth. Hold that up. It's all still in there.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's pretty good.
My Gatorade.
Yeah, do it with your Gatorade.
There you go, there you go, there you go. Nice.
I keep laughing.
Yeah, I don't think I can do that with a pint glass.
Do it, and just it goes like.
Yeah, I just waterboard myself.
Yeah. Oh, like, yeah.
Yeah, like, whoa.
Guck the whole top. Got it. All right, that's a good cold open right there.
Yeah, it's a purely visual like, one, but
yeah, we should keep that for the stream.
Oh yeah, 100%, absolutely.
All right. Metroid Prime 4 is getting a Nintendo Direct.
What? When? Are you shitting me?
No, I heard that, and apparently there's like going to be another Wind Waker remaster, which is like I guess a little less exciting, but.
For like Switch,
yeah, I think so. Maybe it's just like a re-release for the Switch. I don't know.
I have a copy of Wind Waker and it doesn't play.
GameCube or for?
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
and it just doesn't play. So because I wanted to play through it, but
I think I have a copy too. You can try that.
Okay. Yeah, I have a GameCube one, and then I did buy the HD remaster for the Wii U because I'm one of like the 12 people that bought a Wii U.
Yeah. I've heard a lot of really good things about the remaster that it like kind of it gives you like the speedy sail and then it like expedites the Triforce hunting part because
oh yeah that,
I guess
did I tell
but that's because that's like my favorite game but
what so when I first got Wind Waker on the Wii U for the remaster because the Wii U has like internet capabilities they. I don't know if I've told this story on the podcast before, but they have like, they had like these internet things. I got spoiled for Star Wars through Wind Waker HD.
For like the new Star Wars or just Star Wars?
I think it was like the first one, the first new one. So it's like 2015.
Okay, like Force Awakens.
Yeah. They had like these little bottles. Like, you know how you can just find shit in the ocean in Wind Waker?
Yeah.
Like you could write a message in a bottle and like as long as your game was connected to the internet, like other players could like write messages and then you'd find it. And I booted up Wind Waker HD. I was like, oh shit, here's one of those bottles that I heard about. I opened it up and it was like Han Solo dies.
That's
awesome. So it's like oh, okay.
Wait, so is it like messages that other people can write?
Yeah
I guess for the remake or whatever, cool. Or for the remaster.
That's funny.
And then it was like it was either that or like people talking about like brony shit. So I was like, all right, well, I'm disabling this feature. I'm not messing with this anymore.
Yeah, especially if could you include like drawings like that like pick. I forgot the
game. Yeah, I think so. You could draw on them too. Yeah, it, much like a lot of things that Nintendo had in mind, like it was very swiftly abused and turned into just gross shit.
Yeah,
which is pretty good.
Oh, Forest 2 is coming out soon.
Oh yeah.
Oh so yeah.
I feel like that's been in the works for a long time.
But. I would be. You guys did it. You, Nick, and a couple
of
other
people. It was a lot of us for a bit, and then it whittled down to me. I think me, Nick, and Chris were the only ones who finished it.
I
it was only four player.
Not on computer, because we had like six or seven of us playing.
I feel like we only had four at a time. Maybe we had more. No, it was like you, me, Charlie, Kelly,
Chris,
and Chris. I'm just trying to think if we were all simultaneous, but I think at the very least we had like four at a given time.
Because we should definitely like
do Sons of the Forest.
Because like me and Travis, like I don't know if I ever told you that, Nick, but the first one, it was on sale on PS4, and me and Travis or Travis was like, oh yeah, you should check this game out. It looks cool.
Yeah,
and
it's...
I got it, and we played and beat it in like 3 days. We like.
Yeah.
Stayed up till like 5 a.m. I spent the night at his house for like a weekend, and we just like beat it, and it was, oh gosh, that game, it was so much fun. And
yeah,
I don't think it's gonna, you know, kind of like Breath of the Wild 2, I don't think it's gonna hit as hard as the first one, but I'm still
looking
for it.
Yeah, especially because I don't know if it's supposed to be like the same island, because I think it's like what, Timmy returning.
Yeah. I think so, yeah.
And he's got...
Is Timmy the kid's actual name, or is that just what we call them? I forgot.
No, it's his actual name.
Because okay. I remember that was, we like...
We'd use like the walkie-talkie, be like, Timmy!
Yeah.
Yeah, it was...
Oh, yeah, I can see.
Yeah.
Wait, where's the camera?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no. Oh, you're talking about your dad walking around?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can see.
And then, oh, you know, something... do you just do like video games or just,
I don't know. I just, we're doing, we
you
do,
just said Metroid.
We're just doing cold opens, and I just, that was on my mind because I saw that today.
That's wild. Because they dropped that game, like, they dropped that teaser probably like 5 years ago now.
Yeah. It's been so up and down.
Yeah. Which, like, I don't even bother. I don't even get my hopes up. I'll believe it when I see it. But I mean, if they're talking about bringing a Wind Waker remaster to the Switch, I really hope that means that like a Prime Trilogy HD remaster for the Switch.
That'd be so nice.
And what would be really nice is if they fix they update the like the movement system. Because if you play Metroid on like the GameCube right now, you move forward, left and right with like the control stick, you have to stop and then move up and down. It's like almost tank controls, and it's like not super intuitive.
Yeah, like in like compared to nowadays, it's like it's definitely a little clunky. At the time, though, it was like it didn't matter. It was this is amazing.
It's weird how like with the Mario like super or the Mario pack, they had 64 Sunshine and Galaxy. Yeah. Altogether, but like it seems like with Zelda, because they just had the Skyward Sword remake, and like that was $60 full price for a single game, and now they're and I've heard that they're gonna maybe do another Twilight Princess remake too.
I think the way that Nintendo justifies that, at least, is that this Mario ones, those are just basically ports. They like don't change anything.
They don't change anything, but they're definitely remasters. Like they definitely look better.
They might be touched up slightly, but no.
Yeah, like, they might be like upscaled, but like the difference between Wind Waker GameCube and Wind Waker HD remaster, it's a significant difference in terms of like visual.
Actually, still okay,
and they actually like change things within the game too.
Right. Yeah. I'm just saying, if it was me, I'd prefer a 3 set of Zelda. I don't give a shit about graphics. Like, if it plays the same as the old one did,
true.
Skyward Sword. So it's like I don't care.
And that's
Galaga is like a great game, and the graphics on that are 8-bit. So
that's kind of my thought on Wind Waker. Is like you boot that game up on GameCube now, and it's still very pretty. It's a very good looking game, regardless. Yeah. Which, like, at the time, a lot of people, I think, rejected that sort of cartoony look to it. But I think that's what's helped it. That's what's helped it hold up. Because, like, you look at Ocarina of Time, and it's like, this is a big empty space. And there's, the textures are fine. But, like, Wind Waker, it's timeless because of that cartoony style. If they tried to make it super realistic, you'd be like,
I think that's it looks so much better now than Twilight Princess.
Yeah.
Like Skyward Sword goes like half cell shaded like that, and it holds up pretty well.
Holds up all right.
Breath of the Wild also kind of goes sort of cell shaded. I think Breath of the Wild will hold up
forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then Borderlands, like the first Borderlands, it looks.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the third one pretty much just has more, like, compared to like the second or third one, I mean, it just has more stuff in it, more detail, but like that game's never gonna like lose
age or whatever,
like age.
Yeah
Coming to you as live as ever from dim Utah, it's episode 64 of ThereWillBeDuds. I am, as always, I'm your co-host TJ, aka J Spot Jack Cheese, and phoning in from the distant land of Michigan, as always.
As always, at 10:30 p.m., it's Nick, aka Dr. Funk on Twitch, and with you, as always.
As always, as sometimes, I'm Isaiah, also known as Zaybig, or The Poop.
The Poop, yeah.
Or Isaiah 79,
or
Zay Too Big,
or Islaya.
I'm getting your cam setup. I'm getting your old school like Marvel movie reviews in your bedroom vibes. Like you two just like kind of sitting against a wall,
sitting like shoulder to shoulder. Like,
yeah, yeah.
As close as we can be because the room is so small.
Yeah,
yeah. The room is very big. We just like being close to each other.
As always, we watched a movie this week. That movie being The Dead Zone from 1983, directed by David Cronenberg. It is based on the book of the same name by Stephen King. It follows a man with the most generic name ever, Johnny Smith, who, after being in a car accident, because of the car accident, he unlocks some latent psychic abilities where he can see people's futures or, you know, prophesize
presence
by touching them, and
or other people's, not just their own but other people's
and uses it to do stuff.
Help.
It's
a generic man doing generic things.
Yeah, it's like, that's the thing, is like this, this feels like, so it's like such a generic concept by now, right? Like he has psychic powers and like, that's it. At the time, I'm sure it was like,
this
is new, and you know.
Olivia was like, because I watched it with Olivia, and she was like, I have definitely seen a movie just like this. And I was like,
yeah,
but I mean, it's 40 years old almost, so
Stephen King laid the groundwork for a lot of horror like standards and tropes, so it's like, yeah.
And the other thing is, this feels like, and I have a theory about why this is true, this feels like the most Stephen King ass Stephen King story like ever in so many ways. like that template, you know, psychic da da da, but like the way that the story goes is like, it's so him, and like the romantic subplot, and also like the fact that this movie is like, it's like three separate stories almost.
Yeah, it's the pacing and the pacing is weird.
There's like,
it's awkward.
There's like three, it's like,
yeah,
three storylines almost.
Every time it sets up like one of those storylines, at least when, you know, I was watching it, I was like, oh, so this is what it's going to be about. It's going to be about them finding the
and then it's like,
and
nope.
Then it's like, and then it's like, no, he's just a really fucking good psychic, and he figures it out like that.
Yeah.
And and especially what you're saying about Stephen King, like, this is exactly what he does. Like, the ending was like, I thought the ending was fine, but just how like abruptly it ended.
It was an abrupt ending, yeah.
I actually really liked
the ending.
It cuts to black. And then Olivia was like, that's it? Because it was like, I thought it was going to go on for another, you know.
No, there was definitely,
then wrap up.
I think right around the time that we got into the Martin Sheen, Greg Stilson plot, Chloe
Which
was like,
definitely the best.
That
was where I was most like locked into the movie.
Chloe's like, wait, how much longer do we have? And I like hit the thing. It was like 30 minutes. We're like, what?
Yeah,
because that was my first note. The pacing in this was like, because I've read. So yeah, I like collecting first edition copies of Stephen King books for some reason. I found like a second edition copy of The Shining. So like I love those hardcover version. So I found this one years ago and I was like, oh, hell yeah, I'll buy this. And I'm like 80 or so pages into it. And I will say that, I mean, obviously the benefit of a book versus a movie, it is paced much better. And like characters are much more like the Sarah character is much more fleshed out, has way more to do than just being like, hey, here's my baby. Also, let's bone. And like his parents are much more fleshed out. But yeah, like within the first 15 minutes, I was like, oh, okay, we're already past where I've read in the book. We're all like, this is all uncharted territory now.
It did. I don't know if it was just me, but like, especially like when he first like is kind of discovering his power, like, or like, you know, first couple times he uses it, I didn't really understand like what, because, you know, it seems like Stephen King always does stuff where like, people will get powers or abilities or something, but then there's always like a consequence. Like there's always like something evil comes out of the power.
Like a monkey's paw.
Yeah. And he like,
it's, well, it does say that it's killing him. Like,
yeah,
he,
it doesn't does. Matter. But, it doesn't. Yeah. But
yeah,
but they say kind that of, it's killing him. So kind of,
they kind of address that. And then he uses it a couple more times. And then he's just like a couple times. He's just like, ugh. Like, it's not like a, like, I thought he was gonna do like, I thought there was gonna be some like fly shit where he like started like
would expect that of being a Cronenberg
disintegrating and like becoming
right,
gross,
the
becoming Martin Sheen.
But the
this is just a prequel to The West Wing.
Yeah, right.
That's like an alternate timeline where he does win.
Right, the like confusion with the powers. Like at the beginning, it's during the press conference.
Pet conference.
And his mom is like sitting there, and she's like,
"That was insane."
Don't be, you know, don't hurt my boy. Don't do anything. And then he like, it's like when he's like doing a reading on the dude on the reporter, and then she just like. And dies. And
no, we
like,
were like,
I thought it was going to be something like when he uses powers, like
other people, somebody, like
other
suffer,
people die in his
that
family.
Is kind of what it seems like, yeah.
And just how it was timed.
Yeah, that was very strange. I totally.
Well, yeah, because then even like when he goes to the hospital, he's like talking to her. He like he lays on her and hugs her, and then she just like death rattles and is gone.
Dies.
And I'm like, oh god, did he just kill her? Did he just do that? In the book, in the book, it starts out with him. He's like at the fair with Sarah, and he does like a Wheel of Fortune type game. It's like blackjack kind of deal. And he, like, he wins and wins and wins and wins. And, like, he, because I thought it was strange that they included the scene of, like, the kids playing hockey. Because at the very beginning of the book, I'm pretty sure Johnny first starts getting those headaches because he's, like, trying to skate backwards as a young child. And he accidentally skates backwards into a group of hockey players. And I think he gets, like, hit in the head with a puck, or he gets some sort of like traumatic head injury, and then he gets like these headaches, and then I think that's what sort of like gets triggered when he gets in the car accident, and that's what gives him like the psychic powers. But like even before the car accident, like in the book, he's able to like guess which like things the wheel is gonna land on, and he like quadruples up his money and ends up getting like $500.
Okay. He just doesn't realize that he has like an ability.
Like it's kind of like a dull, like he knows that something is weird, like he has like these sort of kind of like a vague awareness of the premonitions, but he's not able to like, you want to know why your sister killed herself, like
right. Mm-hmm. Something funny that Olivia said with like his first premonition of the, I think her name was Amy, the girl in the
burning room. Yeah,
she just goes, why the fuck was nobody there? She's like 7 years old. Like, their house is burning. She's just left home alone. She's like,
she probably started the fire.
Yeah. Like, she was like, what the fuck? That doesn't make any sense.
It's kind of sad, but it did make me laugh. The visual of like the fishbowl getting so hot that it starts boiling and then it just explodes.
Yeah, she would have been dead like 10 minutes ago.
That was, I really liked that scene. And because it was like really, I thought it was a really cool way to depict the premonition. I like the way that he grabbed it and then he was there, like in the room.
Yeah, yeah, that was cool.
They like never do that again. They show premonitions, but it's just like him watch. It's like way less visually interesting.
It's like not Nightmare on Elm Street.
I mean,
like where, or like the Christmas past, Christmas present, Christmas future, where they're just kind of like standing there.
Christmas Carol.
Yeah.
Christmas
Carol, where they're just kind of like standing there watching on. But yeah, the first one,
watching
I was like,
Tiny Tim burned to death.
Yeah. But yeah, that first one was really cool. How it's like the bed is lighting on fire, and you can see like that shit was, it was like practical I because it's like faces like
he was like super like greasy. Yeah. And I wonder if like they had like, because how it looked, they put like the fire resistant gel on him or something.
Yeah.
But it also just looked like he was like sweating. So
They kind of do it again a little bit when they're going over the murder of the woman on like the bandstand where like he's there.
That's true.
But like him on him in the bed on fire is like such a cool visual. And it's like you know, this already kind of has a like made for TV movie feel to it. I feel like if Cronenberg was able to like do this in installments, I really think he probably could have done more with like that kind of stuff. Because I did learn that they did a miniseries of this.
I was gonna say, I feel like this would maybe work way more as a miniseries, because then you have like each one, you have like a three-part miniseries, and each episode is the different arcs or whatever.
Did Stephen King have anything to do with this one? Like,
I want Nick to finish, and then I want to get around to my theory.
Okay,
I didn't look it up, but.
I mean, they did do a miniseries in 2002 with Anthony Michael Hall playing Johnny.
Wait, a mini? Because there was a like a not just miniseries. There was like a TV show.
That I guess that's what I mean. Sorry. Yeah, Yeah, Anthony Michael Hall played Johnny on the 2002 TV show.
That's, I remember that show a lot. Like that's what I go to when I think of.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I did. I maybe vaguely heard about it, but I didn't associate it with like Stephen King at all, for sure.
I don't think I knew it was Stephen King at the time either. I was young, but I definitely remember it. Okay, so this is what I was thinking. Again, didn't look into the Wikipedia or whatever. I meant to to double check, but I'm thinking this is 83.
Mm-hmm.
Not too long after, maybe the next like major release of a Stephen King adaptation since
The Shining.
Stanley Kubrick's The Shining.
Yeah.
Which he infamously hates. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking that he was like, okay, I'll sell you the rights to the Dead Zone, but you got to make it like the book. And then they picked an up-and-coming director like David Cronenberg, who doesn't have as much pull as Stanley Kubrick, and they're like, okay, David Cronenberg, we're gonna give you this big movie, it's gonna put your name on the map, but you gotta do it just like the book. And that's why this movie plays out just like it's like a book. And it's like, yeah, I think it does work more like the structure works more for a book, so they picked someone they could kind of push around.
Yeah. that's well, it's crazy though that this is like, for Cronenberg, this is between Videodrome and The Fly.
Yeah.
That is crazy to me. But yeah,
it's,
I could
so tame.
Because like from what I've read, I think Stephen King was happy with this adaptation. I do think he liked it.
He has to be, because it's a fucking Stephen King book. It's like,
yeah, it doesn't even feel like a David Cronenberg movie, like at all. Like, I mean, it's competently directed, which David Cronenberg is a competent director. The only time that we were watching it and I was like, oh, okay, this is a Cronenberg movie, was when the Dodd character, like, sets up the scissors and then, like, eats him like that. I was like, oh, okay. And it did cut away, which is like, okay, fine. If it was a Cronenberg movie, you would have seen him like snipping like into his head or something.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that was rough. Like, I when that was when he was like setting up to do that, I was like, oh, for some reason, like that thought of like just like slowly like,
Yeah,
because he was like, I thought he was just gonna like,
that's what I thought too.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, and then he puts his mouth around it. I was like, no, no, no. Because he's it's almost like a diversion because you're like, okay, yeah, he's going to like slit his wrists or something. And then it's like, oh, no, it's infinitely worse than that.
Yeah,
that's probably what was in the book. And David Cronenberg was like, no, I get this one thing.
Yeah, let me have my one horribly grotesque death.
Wait, Liv, go like 2 feet over this way.
Can you see that?
Yeah, you can see that.
Freya the dog.
Right there.
Boop.
Right, boop. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I need to, like, because, like, you guys have your, like, name tags on the screen. I need to get one that, like, tracks on, like, Olivia and your dad. So, like, every time they walk by, their little name tag, like, follows them. Yeah. Like Too Many Cooks when they have their, like, name tag on their chest.
Yeah. Yeah, speaking of the Dodd character in the murder part, which again I would think if you have more time to breathe with this it might work better, but I just thought it was like almost silly how they're like, please help us solve this murder, and he's like, no. I don't want to, and then he's like, okay, I'll do it, and he like instantly solves it. So it's like, hey, you could have saved those last two people from dying if you had just said yes earlier. Yeah. Like, you definitely. I thought it was gonna like, yeah, because at that point, like you guys, like I thought that was gonna be the rest of the movie, and he was gonna, like he touches the girl's body, and he's like, oh no, he's like, I can almost see it, and I was like, okay, right, like he does this, and he almost gets it, but then, you know, they need to like he needs to go touch a few more dead bodies and solve it, but then he's just like, oh no, wait, there it is.
Yeah, and he's like. And then every time you see it, it just cuts to him for like a half second. He's like,
yeah, that's right.
He's getting that gank.
having psychic powers every time you read, you just like bust a fatty.
I forget if this is, because my notes are, again, I don't fully remember these, but. I put milk truck just arrive. Is that the one that he like?
That's the
one that causes his car accident.
Yeah, it is.
Wait, what?
It's a milk truck that like? That's what causes his accident.
It's a milk truck?
Yeah,
it is.
It was just like a tanker.
It's very clearly a milk truck because that's why I pointed it out, because it was. I think it just said like milk on the side.
It did.
Stuff.
It did. Yeah.
Milk truck. But it was in like an oil tanker.
Yeah. Something.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah. That's awesome. And then I said, I don't remember this, but I put semen tongue twister at beginning. Also his voice and his hair. Can't wait for his transformation into Christopher Walken. Because he has like that little bowl cut and like the glasses, and he's like, I'm a normal person. I'm not Christopher Walken.
Yeah.
Oh, that's something that I said was, it seemed like, because I don't know how big was Christopher Walken like before this.
Who's in the Deer Hunter?
Yeah, he was. Okay. He was pretty.
Because it's
set at this point.
It definitely seemed like he wasn't like his voice.
Like, oh, he had it.
He was. He had
it. Ice is gonna break.
That was a good one.
I love that part.
Now, don't give me any argument. The ice is gonna break.
It wasn't as like pronounced as something like Seven Psychopaths or something, or just any of his newer stuff.
Yeah,
I think like he was like trying not to do his normal. Like I noticed, I was like, man, like he sounds like. Normal, I guess.
I think it's less his voice and more his cadence, like the way that he speaks.
Yeah,
he wasn't like talking like this, like there, you know.
But it's not. It's this. It's he has very weird pauses. In his sentences, but I didn't really notice it a ton in this movie, and it was kind of because I told Olivia, I was like, oh yeah, Christopher Walken's in this. I love Christopher Walken. And I like Christopher Walken a lot just because of his cadence. I think it's really funny to just like listen to him. But I didn't notice it as much in this movie. Not saying.
I just like that like more. I think part of that too is like when he was younger, he was more playing roles, and I feel like he's one kind of like a Morgan Freeman, where like the last like 15, 20 years, he's playing Christopher Walken.
Yeah.
But when he was younger, he was playing, you know, characters.
Right.
Right, so right.
I think now he's just kind of being himself more because people are like, oh, it's Christopher Walken, you know.
Yeah, do it. Do the thing. Do the thing. Come on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
No, I won't do it. I think the casting did work, but again, in the book, like the characters of Johnny and Sarah are like, they are like just out of college.
Yeah.
Like they're like early 20s, like high school teachers. And I was like, oh, Christopher Walken's in this, and it's 1980. Oh, he's 40 years old in this.
Yeah, no, he's clearly 20, 22,
23. Yeah, yeah. Dear Evan Hansen'd him. Like,
yeah.
Also, a decent amount of fun little Easter egg characters. Apparently, I was looking at the IMDb casting, and I was trying to find the scene in the movie, and I couldn't. But I don't know if you noticed it, but William B. Davis, apparently, is one of the paramedics. I couldn't find him. But I was like, oh, shit, the smoking man is in this? And then the actress who played Sarah, for a second, I thought it was Puffy Nips from Amadeus. It is not.
Oh, really?
For a second, I thought it was her. But the only other thing I've seen her in is she plays Richard Gere's wife in Days of Heaven, the Terrence Malick movie.
Oh, I saw that on her credits, yeah. I thought she looked like Talia Shire. That's who she reminded me of.
Who is that?
Well, she was in Deadfall, for instance, but she's in The Godfather.
Oh, okay.
She's the daughter who's getting, you know, the day of my daughter's wedding. Like she's the
Okay.
Yeah, she's also a Coppola, so that's why she's in that in Deadfall.
Oh, I was gonna say there was an Estevez.
Yeah, I know.
No, there was like a younger Estevez as like the kid photographer.
Like Charlie or Emilio?
Or was No. It was a different one.
Oh.
But I was like, okay, I wonder how he got that role on the film.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, okay, Martin Sheen's in this.
Yeah, I don't know, like I dug the like, cause that's like, I mean, I don't think they had as much of like a kind of side by side sort of legacy like Pacino and De Niro, but that kind of for me was like the Heat scene, like just Martin Sheen and Christopher Walken like kind of squaring off, like face, like I loved any like scene with those two,
yeah,
like especially like face to face, which wasn't that much, but like I love Martin Sheen, I like seeing him play a scumbag.
Yeah,
Christopher Walken made this movie work way more than it should have for me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I don't think I would have like enjoyed it
if it was like a nobody.
If it was some lesser person, but like he's so fucking—he's just really charming. He's
apparently
a really charming actor.
Stephen King wanted Bill Murray.
Really?
That was his first choice.
Very interesting. Yeah. God damn, he's just imagine if he had.
He's such a nerd.
Imagine if Stanley Kubrick didn't get to do what he did with The Shining. Oh my God.
Well, it's not that hard to imagine because there is the made for TV The Shining that Stephen King had like a huge hand in, and it sucked dog shit.
Right.
And I guess I'm saying like just if there was a world without Stanley Kubrick's The Shining. Like,
yeah, exactly.
There was a Shining that Stephen King like did.
That's what he was saying.
Oh, yeah, there was
you were saying it.
No. Stephen King was like part of like a made for TV, like either movie or miniseries of The Shining. Yeah, and it's like,
and it sucked.
I've watched some of it on YouTube because I think the whole thing's up there.
Is that after or before?
It was after, I think.
Because he was like pissed.
Yeah, it was like in the '90s, I think.
He was like
Stephen Weber's Jack.
Yeah. I think he was mostly just mad at like the Jack Nicholson casting, because in the book, again, in the book version, Jack is not like readily apparent that he's insane, but it's like Jack Nicholson already looks like an insane person, but also he's perfect for that role. So I see what you're saying, but also it's Jack Nicholson.
Stephen King wrote Dreamcatcher, so, you know, he's I think Stephen King should just stick to his books. I don't know.
His books, from what I've read, his books are decent. He's a decent author, but like when it comes to adapting him, it's so weird. I don't know of any other author that has like such a like, it's like he's difficult to adapt, but I feel like the stories really aren't. They shouldn't be.
Yeah.
But I mean, just for there's something about it.
He's a very commercial, like, I think he's such a success because he's like a mainstream horror writer. Like he's very accessible if you want to get into like horror literature. All his stories are like not that what's the word I'm trying to think of? They're not that like demanding, or they're not that they're very straightforward. They don't, I don't know, none of them have
unassuming ever made you, like, think almost super I don't know
hard or they don't ask too much of you. But they're solid. You know, it's kind of like Harry Potter. Like I'm not a huge Harry Potter fan, but I think they are really solid books and like totally deserving of like the popularity that they have. For, you know, the Stephen King books that are generally accepted as good, because he does have a few clunkers. I think they're good, but none of them have ever like really sat with me, you know. I've never like finished a Stephen King book and been like, wow, that just like changed my, you know, blew my mind or whatever, you know. But they're like good solid reads.
I mean, I will say, having read the short story version of The Shawshank Redemption, it's insane to me that the guy who wrote like this movie also wrote like The Shawshank Redemption, and like that adaptation is like, I don't know how you feel about that movie, but it's like, or generally
like,
yeah,
those two movies are just
I love Shawshank,
so good.
Yeah, it's just crazy that like the same guy that did that also wrote those movies,
or It remakes, like those are both
pretty solid.
The first
they're decent.
The first one's like, the second one's okay, but the first one's like a good like horror movie.
Yeah, I would say
it's a pretty good like horror movie, and it's definitely weird that it's the same person.
Pennywise is such a good, he's just such a good character.
Yeah,
I think like,
and also casting for both of the movies was just like, for both.
Yeah,
of
yeah,
them,
yeah.
It one and two were like really good. So, and I think that maybe is a big part of I mean, we're saying like all these movies that are good, like good Stephen King books, and the casting in all of them are like perfect, almost like It, the new It's, all the casting is really good. Shining,
that's it.
No, Shawshank and Green Mile, those movies. It's like
Dreamcatcher.
The casting is just great in all of them.
I mean, my profile picture on Discord is Tom Hanks taking like a righteous piss from the Green Mile.
Yeah, that's right.
I feel like Stephen King just needs to be reined in, or I don't know. It's just because I feel like in again, like even reading this book, the way that he kind of goes into like the character's thoughts and feelings and backstory, I'm like, oh, this is pretty good. But it's like, it's really hard to portray that in the movies, like in an engaging way, I guess. Like, it would be hard to like not make it 4 hours long if you really wanted to include all the stuff. Cause like, dude, I was like, oh cool, I have this book, I want to read this like before I watch the movie. And then in the book, in the prologue, it's like a scene from 1955. And you start out with Greg Stilson? And it's just like, it's a scene of him. He's like a traveling Bible salesman. And like the very first scene is him showing up to a farmhouse. Family's not home. He gets out. A dog like confronts him. And then like the rest of it is just him like kicking the dog to death. And I'm like, oh, cool. Like, awesome. Can't wait. Can't wait to watch this movie now, which of course they didn't include it at all.
Yeah, because you don't need that.
But I think
I feel like something that they Sorry, you can.
But I think the idea is that, like, because that's a very common characteristic in, like, sociopaths. When they're young, they tend to, like, kill and or torture, like, neighborhood animals. So I think that's kind of, like, the go-to. If you want to depict someone who's, like, a young sociopath, that's just kind of what they do. Like, they don't feel empathy. But I'm glad they didn't include that in the movie.
Yeah, it's like, it's a very, I guess, that's kind of what I mean about, like, Stephen King. Like, it's a very, like, I need, like, you're just saying, like, I need to show this guy is a bad guy. Like, but, like, you don't need it. Like,
yeah.
The movie doesn't include that. You don't see him. You hear, mention of him, but you don't see him in person until halfway, two-thirds of the way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like, you got more. He's a Republican. You know that he's a piece of shit.
I mean, the only thing that I could say that I wish that the movie would have done with, you know, that character is Stilson. Just have some threads that start at, like, the beginning of the movie, or, like, right when he comes out of the coma. Just have him, like, have it kind of through the whole movie, and then it's like, that's, it's like, oh,
if this
shit.
If this was written as a movie first, that's how it would have been done.
Yeah.
But with a book, you can do that. You can have a character, like, not in, although apparently it opens with him, but you can have a character, like, hardly in it.
Yeah.
The last chunk, and it's still.
The book does a decent job of, like, when Johnny's in a coma, it kind of goes from different scenes with Sarah kind of corresponding with Johnny's parents still, but then after year two of him being in the coma, they stop writing her as much, and then she meets Walt, whatever that guy, and then it kind of intercuts all the different threads until Johnny wakes up. It does an okay job of that. I'm still, like, gonna finish the book. Like, it's pretty good, but
I laughed pretty hard at the end where it was like, because I knew, you know, pretty much when he's like, oh, would you kill Hitler, to the doctor, it's like, okay, he's gonna go kill him, or something is gonna, he's gonna be the hero, you know, or he's gonna, you know, change the future. And I was kind of thinking he might just shoot him, but I was like, that seems a little, like, too, you know, I think.
A little bleak.
Something. Yeah, but the way that they change it, and that.
It was a good little twist.
He George Costanzas himself.
Well, no, just how he. It's like he grabs the baby and just is like. Using him as a body shield. I thought that was so fucking funny. It just shows, like, or not show, it just, like, I feel like there would have been a smarter way to, like, make him seem like a piece of shit in that moment. Not something so obvious as, like, holding a fucking baby that he just kissed.
It's very, like, I like the ending just because I, like, it was not quite what I was expecting. I thought it was, I don't know, it was kind of cool, and it was, like, kind of shocking.
It played with the concept well, I think, because you're, like, that, you know, it shows him with, like, the nuclear codes. You're like, oh shit, he needs to kill this guy. Yeah. But then it's like, I'm gonna ruin your career until you commit suicide.
Well, I mean, he, you know, that wasn't his plan. It just kind of he was very lucky. The biggest piece of shit ever. I almost thought, my thinking was that it was gonna do what I feel like every other, like, premonition-y thing, the cliche is like, he was gonna do that, and then, like, that he was gonna, like, touch him at the end or whatever, and, like, find out that, like, his assassination attempt was going to lead him to
victory,
to like pressing the button or whatever.
That
he saw or something like that. I thought, you know, because you see that a lot where, like, they try preventing it, and then it's like, oh no,
I caused
me,
it.
By me doing that caused a bad thing or whatever. So I liked it. I said, that was the storyline that I was the most interested in, and it kind of, I don't know, like, I was like, holy shit, like, Martin Sheen's a piece of shit, but I didn't even really think about there being photographers. So when Christopher Walken got shot, I was like, oh shit, so that's it. Like, he lost. And then, like,
he touches him and sees that. I was like, oh, okay. So like,
yeah, I kind of figured that out as soon as he grabbed the baby and started doing that. I was like, okay, this is going to be a very outward. Let's go. I thought I was like, okay, no, this is like, this is him very obviously like fight or flight. I don't want to die. Like, but I'm also a piece of shit. It was very obvious that like, I was like, okay, this is what's going to be his downfall. Is like, he's literally grabbing a baby to protect himself. Like,
yeah. It, just yeah. like, just that image is just really funny of like, and when he like, when the gun is like over the magazine and then he like moves it, I was like, holy fucking shit. I thought that was, I went and like laughed, and my dad was like, he's like, are you crying? Like, no, because it was like Christopher Walken was like dying right there. I was like, no, this is fucking hilarious.
But, yeah, there were a few shocking moments like that. Like when it's like it's him like just grabbing the gun. Chloe and I were just like, oh, holy shit, he's gonna go assassinate this guy. The other moment was like when Sarah comes over to his house and like brings the baby with her, like puts the baby to sleep, and then she's like, oh, you know, you said some things are worth the wait. Well, you waited, and then I was like, oh, okay. And then she just starts unbuttoning her thing. I was like, oh, we're doing this now.
I was like, this is a dream sequence. This is
a dream sequence. I thought the same thing.
But then it just kept going. I was like, oh, it's not. Oh. But like every scene with them, like before then, after his car accident, she was like, oh, you know, I've moved on, you know, sorry, Johnny.
Yeah.
I know it's just been a day for you, but I have a new life now, sorry.
Oh, I could.
And then she's like, nah, come on.
I felt like I could totally tell that she wanted to fuck. Like when she came in and like, and then she was like crying when she like drove away from the hospital and stuff. I was like, yeah, she wants to fuck him again.
I guess I took that as like, you can not want to have to like cheat on your husband, but still like cry because of. That's it. I don't know. I didn't take it as that. Like, you can.
Chloe immediately hated her for all of that.
Really?
Oh yeah. Just like she came to like visit him in the hospital. She's like, "Why are you dressed like a slut?" It's like, oh shit. It's like, oh yeah, you're crying. Yeah, you should be. Just like immediate was like hating on her is so funny.
Yeah, and that was, that whole thing was like, I thought for the rest of the movie it was like fine or normal, but I also felt just like that their dialogue between those two was like really clunky, really weird. Like they're like, I love you and I'm gonna marry you very soon,
yeah,
but I'm gonna drive home now. And then, you wanna stay here? No, I should go home. I will wait until after marriage. And like,
and then he runs, and then he starts walking away, and then she's like, wait, hang on. And then she like runs out.
Yeah.
We're so in love.
I'm so crazy about you.
I'm gonna marry you, you know?
You better.
Yeah, did they say something like that? Or,
I mean, they're like, I mean,
I feel like there was some,
there's
like,
some.
I don't think it gets that bad, but
yeah, it's not that bad, but it's definitely like very like kids writing.
Yeah,
it's almost
yeah.
like child yeah. like a you'd see in like a Goosebumps book.
Like, I mean, this is David Cronenberg. This is not his forte. His forte is like
that's
body
true.
Horror, so he's yeah. like, oh god, romance shit. I don't know, man. I again, I, th-
and
I feel
Stephen
like
King both. It's a bad combo.
Yeah, it's like I've referenced this so many times, but it's the John C. Reilly scene from Boogie Nights when they're in the hot tub. He's like, I wrote a poem. You want to hear it? And he's like, I love you, you love me. Let's go down to the sugar bush tree. We can hang out with a bee. Just it's like, oh, you wrote that? Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah. Okay. Are we good to go?
Yeah, I'm good.
Are we good to move on? Discourse?
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. Let's go first.
I'll go first. Okay. Pretty solid six. I thought it was pretty good. I thought the performances were pretty good. The story was compelling enough, albeit the pace was crazy.
Yeah.
You know, it's like David Cronenberg's a competent director, even though it didn't really feel like a David Cronenberg movie. It's his movie in between Videodrome and The Fly. Like, it's kind of a weird, you know what? It's his Jackie Brown. It's it is like because it's like, I think it went Scanners, Videodrome, this, and then like The Fly. So it's like, it's like right in his peak. I think it was The Brood first, but
right, yeah, Brood was
kind of fun. Yeah, it was fine. It was average.
Yeah,
it was one of the better Stephen King adaptations in a sea of
that is true. Yeah,
you know, some sketchy waters there. I mean, I don't know if I ever put it in the cup or not, but I do feel like we should revisit The Langoliers, which was
I don't know if you did, but that would be good.
It's a made-for-TV movie that I read the short story last year, and the movie does not hold up like it did for my childhood. It scared the shit out of me as a kid.
I could see the monsters, like, as a kid, those, like, freaking me out.
And yeah, it was awful.
Yeah, but now it's just like, oh my god.
Yeah.
CGI. Yeah.
I'm at a six. It's pretty good. It's all right.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I'm also six. That's where I landed. I really think this is like a 5, maybe 5.5 movie, but I think, I really think Christopher Walken like put it into the positive for me. Because yeah, like, you know, we said it's a really awkward structure, very played out story, but it is, you know, you can't say, you know, it's one of the early ones, so you can't really knock it too much for that. It's just nothing super surprised me.
Like I said
Christopher Walken is so fucking charming. Like, every time he smiled, I was like, oh man, he's like, I don't know, he's just great. And yeah, like I said, Martin Sheen too. So like that, the casting of those two, yeah, sets it up a little above that average mark. So, and like you said, yeah, for a Stephen King adaptation, it's one of the best, and it's a six. So
maybe it's because I just watched Severance and I love Christopher Walken as Bert.
Yeah.
That I just have a soft spot for him.
Yeah,
this makes my hairline look like it's. this one's kind of hard for me to place. I guess I want to give it just like a 5 right on the dot, but I think I gotta give it like a 4.9 or something like that. Not 4.99, because it's like
repeating.
Yeah,
I'm not doing that.
It's or just whatever. Say a 5 if you're gonna write it down.
Okay. Why are you putting it?
Because I guess I judge movies a lot on like, would I recommend this, and would I, you know, watch it again and stuff. And like, I don't think I'd recommend it. I don't think I'd ever care to watch it again. And like, I did.
I would agree with both of those.
I wasn't at a point where I was like, I want to turn this off, but I wasn't ever at a point where I was like, so, you know, like on the edge of my seat, like super involved. Like, I was kind of like, yeah, it's fine. It's
to me, it's the most movie of all time.
But, yeah, really. But I will say that there was some parts where I was just like, okay, can this speed up, or can this, be, you know, that's why I'm like, I'm closer to like a 5.5. Even though it's higher than that, but like right at a 5, just because it's, I mean, me and Olivia were both just like, it was a movie, I guess. Yeah. Like, it was something to watch. And
I feel like it really, really, really dragged when it was him like hanging out with the kid, like the ice skater kid,
mm-hmm.
which Chloe was like, oh, is that like the kid from the killing of a sacred deer that eats the spaghetti. Which you thought he looked like a young, like, Barry Keoghan.
Yeah, and they kind of, like, just, like, some of the... I think because it was made, it was, like, adapted as a book and not, like, adapted to a movie. Like, it was... Mm-hmm. I think that that hurt it, definitely. I think if it was... If they would have made it as a movie and tried to have, like, some... Like, the plot lines flow through the whole movie instead of just, like...
Yeah,
here's,
yeah.
Here's something, here's another thing, here's another thing. I think it would have made it a lot better, but...
Oh, did that just look weird?
No, I think you could see shirtless dad walking in the back. Yeah. So yeah. Didn't hate it, didn't love it. It's just right. It was fine.
Yeah, it was okay.
Yeah. I was just gonna say, like, if there were more moments like the ending with the baby thing where it, like, made me laugh, mm-hmm. if there was more stuff like that, I would
or almost... more of those, like, cool premonitions with Amy, more of, like, him using his powers and, like, kind of seeing that kind of shit. No, I know what you're saying.
Like, this, yeah, like, just the stuff that made me laugh, I would almost consider this being, like, in the dud cup. Like, in a way, because if there was like, four or five more, there would have to be more moments throughout, but, like, that part at the end with the baby, like, being held up, that made me feel like this is...
There it goes again.
It made me feel like this is a good, bad movie. I had that, like, feeling of, like, oh, this is funny.
Yeah.
Like,
I think you're gonna get that with a lot of Stephen King adaptations too. Like,
unless you get the ones
that, I mean, yeah, there's moments in The Shining that are like that too, where it's like just
the skeletons when she, like, what, and the skeletons are like, I don't know. It's
there's some goofy stuff in that, but no, definitely.
I disagree. That's a bird movie. So,
so yeah.
All right.
Oh.
But speaking of should be in the dud cup, here's an ad break. Are we back?
I'm thinking I'm back. I'm back.
Okay, are we going to
If we don't have anything to talk about.
We have to have
an icebreaker, because, you know, the ice is gonna break.
The ice is gonna break. Yeah. I love that scene. That was a good
scene. But Let's Go, that made me think of, have you guys seen the lawyer on TikTok? The guy that he ends all of his videos by going, "Let's go," and they are some of the funniest fucking things. Like, he's like,
unintentionally,
yes. Oh. But, like,
he sounds like cancer.
No, but he's like, he's not okay. It's unintentionally funny, but, like, he is aware that it is, like, it's
like cringe.
That it's kind of like cringe and, like, funny.
Is this the guy that Connor was talking about when we were talking about Better Call Saul? I wonder, because he mentioned, like, a lawyer on TikTok that I
don't know. There is one on YouTube. I know, like, I forget what it's called.
I think his name, it's like, he goes by, like, PNP.
The one on TikTok.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And he'll be like outside the courthouse with his client, and he'll be like. "All right, guys, so we just got out of the courthouse, and this is my client here," and, like, not exaggerating at all. He'll be like, "So he was drunk driving, and he was on multiple substances, and he crashed his car into an oncoming vehicle and rolled it, and the firefighters came and used the jaws of life, and when they pulled him out, he started fighting with them, and... we got him off on 30 days community service, and he can be back on the road tomorrow." And it, like, multiple TikToks of him, like, just people with like multiple DUIs, and he gets them off.
Says, let's
and
go.
Then he, and then he'll be like, are you happy with what happened? And the client will just be like, yeah, I'm really happy, thank you so much. And then he's just like, let's go.
Oh, you should
check them out, they're fucking hilarious.
He hits him with like the Burger King foot lettuce cadence. It's like, let's go.
That's it's like literally it. Yeah, let's go.
I'm just thinking of the inverse of that, where he's just like, yo, what's up? This guy just got sentenced to life in prison. He's not seeing the light of day ever again. Like, no possibility of parole.
Let's go to prison.
I know. Okay, I saw it on the H3 podcast.
This isn't going to play on the podcast.
No, I know. I'm just looking it up to show you after.
Okay.
We haven't really been watching a ton of like new stuff. I did convince Chloe to start watching Atlanta, which I've seen the first season, seen most of the second season, and I haven't really seen anything beyond. But the first season I remember is pretty damn great, and like we've been watching it, and it's been funny. But then at the end of some of those episodes, she's just like, "Yeah, it's kind of a bummer." It's like, "Yeah, that's kind of how that show works."
So something I want to ask is, I want to be on another episode upcoming.
Okay.
Recently.
Okay.
When's the next?
It won't be for a little while.
The Halloween dud?
Yeah, it'll be our Halloween dud.
Okay. And what episode will that be?
69.
Okay. Can I be on that one?
Maybe, yeah, probably.
Okay. Do you know what the movie's going to be?
I think so. We haven't 100% nailed it down, but
you might not want to be on it based on what the movie is.
Why?
Well, I don't want to say anything.
Oh.
Yeah, that's.
But yeah, I'll tell you off air. Okay. Yeah. I want to save it. But yeah, we're going to do something themed. Yeah.
Okay, good. I definitely want to be on that.
I mean, I'll pitch it now. But if you guys are going to be around in October, I feel like much like the Jack Frost Christmas episode, if you guys wanted to do like a themed in-person Halloween episode with
that would be awesome.
That would be cool.
Like costumes or something and lights and like...
Oh, yeah.
I think that'd be a lot of fun if we wanted to do that.
Especially if we did it, the costumes based on the movie.
Okay, so...
I'm going to build a prosthetic with a... Yeah.
Sex stuff.
Yeah.
Did you have anything else? Just that.
No. Just that. Just 69 and let's go.
Okay.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Well. I guess since nobody said anything to what Nick said about Atlanta. Yeah, I gotta rewatch it. I don't know.
I did.
It's been a long time. I don't remember much about the show, but I know. Yeah, I mean, that's one that people love. Yeah.
I did see a preview for it.
Well, they're dropping like their final season, in a few days from now.
And I saw the.
You've watched most of it, right? Have you watched all of it?
I haven't watched any of it.
I thought you had.
And I saw the trailer for it, and I was like, I should check this out because I know it's.
You should give it a shot.
So, and I've heard that it's a good show. So,
well, hey, how about this? If I'll convince you this way, a bunch of the episodes of Barry, directed by Hiro Murai, directed like most of Atlanta.
Oh, okay.
Like same director.
Okay.
Oh,
so
what'd you
think
of the most recent season of Barry?
I thought it was a little sluggish. I definitely think season one and two were better. I think I told Nick this because me and him were talking about it a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't like how it's kind of like, I don't know what to, not Scooby-Doo, but it's like everything always, like the past three seasons, everything has worked
so
out
the
for
whole
Barry.
Show.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. The whole show. It seems like the first couple seasons, or the first two seasons, it's like it kind of works.
there's just like these insane coincidences that somehow, like, manage.
He gets off somehow.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that, but like he gets away with it. And it's just a little like, and then the third season, it's a little played out, and then he gets fucking caught, and it's like, holy shit. Like the season finale, I was like, okay, let's go. Like, I'm excited for the next season.
Really? I just, my concern is, like, I don't know. I guess I could see it playing out one of two ways. Like, I don't want them to just, like, take one episode and just, like, some sort of, like, random happenstance means that he just gets out scot-free because they didn't follow some, like, obscure legal proceeding. So, like, it makes the whole case, null and void.
I want it to be like he's a prison hitman now or something. Like, he's in prison. Like,
I could see them doing the whole next season in prison.
And, next season and, like, half of season five.
He's like a Hannibal Lecter type character. Like,
I think that it could. But I think that some of season. Like, there wasn't, like, the memorable episodes like season two. Like, the Lillian. What was that
episode? The one with, like, the karate girl.
Yeah. Like, that episode is so, like, memorable and so good. And, like, the season finale to both of the seasons before. And there's just some really good, right after he kills his, like, Marine friend.
Oh, yeah.
And then, Chris, goes and does his one line. And he's, like, sobbing. And it's, like, that scene is so good. But season three, there's really any memorables.
The queen is dead, or the king is dead.
Yeah. There's not any, like, memorable episodes like that, except for the final episode, I thought.
I would say the motorcycle chase.
Really?
Yeah. The motorcycle chase. The motorcycle chase was really cool.
Oh, yeah. That was cool.
Yeah.
You hated the ending? My.
I hated it. I felt like it was so unearned. I hate that there's this... I mean, he's not Rancher. He's tied to What's-Her-Nuts.
Sally.
Henry Winkler's girlfriend.
Oh.
It's his dad. It's her dad.
I know that, but, like, he wasn't in the show. I don't know.
Oh,
I didn't like how that character just comes in and he's like, oh, I know. I've perfectly deduced everything and da da da.
Oh,
and,
like, just I see what you're saying.
The whole setup of it. I don't understand these characters still. Like, I do not understand the character of Barry. I don't understand, Barry Zuckerkorn. I can't grasp, like, what they are feeling and what their motivations are. So,
I will say
at the end just felt so just like, okay, sure.
I think that Henry Winkler's character was a little weird this whole season, because he was like, at the end of season two, he's like, I want to fucking kill, like, he's like, I will do anything to, like, it seems like he's like, he's gonna, like, go after Barry, and then he's like, Barry's like, well, I'll just kill you and your son, and that's the thing where it's, and then he's like, okay, well, whatever. It's like him just, like, getting away with it, where I didn't like that. But I will say the NoHo Hank, that plot line was, I like that a lot.
NoHo Hank has consistently been the best part of the show for me.
Yes,
Hank is great. I mean, I will say to your credit, you know, I guess the whole idea that, like, Barry wants to, like, get some sort of catharsis from acting sure doesn't seem like he gives a whole lot of a shit about it, because he doesn't seem to try very hard.
Yeah.
So it's like, I guess it's like, it's kind of a funny idea for, like, a pilot, but then the fact that they, like, kept going on with it, and it's just like, it's kind of weak, because it doesn't seem like he really actually gives a shit about it.
Yeah, that could be.
Only maybe so, like, he can, like, smash with Sally or whatever.
Yeah, that's definitely gonna be something with the next season. Unless there's, like, acting class in prison.
He, like, starts an acting class in prison. Yeah,
it's definitely gonna go away from the. You know, hitman actor.
Yeah, season. I mean, season three already felt like it was, like, abandoning that pretty quick.
Yeah.
I thought the what's her face from eighth grade. I thought she was gonna have more of a bigger role, but she just kind of disappeared.
Yeah.
Who's
She's the younger actress who's working with Sally on her like.
She sees Barry come in and like freak out, and she's like, "Barry's a violent, she's kind of like your stand-in for like your young, like Gen Z social justice person." He's like, "He has a lot of toxic masculinity." Like that's kind of her whole character. But I was like, I was waiting for her to be like the person who like deduces like who Barry actually is, but. Yeah. She just kind of had her little moment to tell Sally to break up with him, and then she's out of the picture.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, no. It was definitely not like as strong.
I feel like it has to end with like this season. I really feel like it can't. I don't know how much further they can really go with it.
Yeah.
Before it becomes like a parody of itself.
I mean, I do think that like Bill Hader is like, I will say, like, the show is still, like, really funny. Like, there's a lot of, like, funny parts in the show, and I really like Bill Hader. I think he's a really good actor. And
He does a really good job in that show.
And Henry Winkler also is, like, awesome. I just love him.
Christopher Walken.
It just doesn't...
That's what they need.
It doesn't have the same, like, feel, I guess. But, like I said... Yeah, I don't think season 3 was amazing, but I'm excited for season 4. It feels like it was kind of a, not quite a gas leak year, but a... It felt more like it's going to be a stepping stone for the next season. It's not like...
Yeah.
It's just set up.
Ooh, I just had a thought for some vault content, maybe. Ooh. If we wanted to, like, and I guess it is dependent on seasonal shit, but if we wanted to rank, like, our favorite holiday episodes of TV shows.
Oh. Ooh.
I only say this because we just watched the, one of the community Halloween episodes, the zombie one.
The Halloween episodes are great.
I would say, like, Community's, like, themed episodes of, like, holidays are.
For the most part. It's I don't like Abed's Uncontrollable Christmas.
The claymation one?
The claymation one.
Really? I love that.
Other than season 4, like
the puppet.
One of the most I was going to say other than season 4, one of like the most skippable episodes. Like maybe the one probably the one I would skip over any other episode.
It's weird. I've been flying through It's Always Sunny, and I'm on their Christmas episode that I think is in that same style, and it's like 40 minutes long, and I'm just like, I can't.
Yeah. Oh, the Christmas movie.
A Very Sunny Christmas.
Yeah. For some reason, I haven't watched it yet. I get to it, and I see that it's like 44 minutes long, and I see that it's animated, and something in my brain.
Song that's animated.
It's not fully done in like the old school.
There's like literally one scene. It's like a couple minutes.
I'm dumb then, because the thumbnail is that, so I assumed the entire episode was like that. So I was like,
it's like a
fantasy type.
No, I'm trying to think, like not South or like a Robot Chicken, like.
Oh, okay.
Like where it's just like goes way over the top, or Happy Tree Friends. Is that what that
channel was called?
Yeah. It's kind of like that. It's
okay.
I think that episode's pretty good. There's a couple things with Charlie that are.
I just gotta watch it and then I can keep going. But I was gonna say that Community Halloween episode is like perfectly up your alley though, because the Dean's entire playlist is ABBA the whole night.
We just watched that one too, not that long ago.
And there's a decent amount of lore too, because that's when Chang and Shirley hook up in the bathroom, and that plays out later in like the pregnancy episode, something.
That's a good one. And I'm trying to think.
It's a good show.
I think. I don't know. There's a couple really. It's like if you're gonna do that, the holiday episodes. Like, without a doubt, it's got to be one of the Community ones because they're just like tops. They're all so good. Like the first season Christmas episode is great,
and the third season, the Glee body snatchers.
That's one of my favorites. That's one of the most memorable episodes for me.
Yeah, yeah. Third season Halloween episode is really good. Yeah. Where they're all insane.
They all tell different horror stories.
Yeah,
or like spooky stories, and like, yeah. That's and then at the great. End.
They're like, oh, you fucked up the test. And then they're all insane, except for Abed.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. No, oh, I was going to say... Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I feel like Community just... They just nails those.
Yeah, they do, yeah. Because
that's what Community is like. Good, that just like nailing concepts like that. That's what that show
except
is,
for
excels at.
Thanksgiving season 4, that is one of the
that's season 4.
I because me and Olivia are, because we just watched like Game of Thrones and some other like heavy stuff and like long like episode like 45 hour long shows, and I was like, we should just like
our episodes
no for like I was like, we should just do something like easy like Community, because they're 20 minute episodes. You can watch
six
of them in a night and not feel, you know, like you can rip through it. And she's seen it once or twice mm-hmm. all the way through. And I've seen it like 10 or 15 times. And every other time I've been like, all right, I'm going to give season 4 another shot. I'm going to do it. I'm going to try it again. And we both agreed. We're like, we're fuck that. We're just skipping it. Yeah. It's so there's nothing
positive to be gained.
In a vacuum, I think it is comparable to like The Big Bang Theory or something like that. Like it is so like it is fine for like general TV audiences, but fans of the show, it's like I can't fucking stand it. I can't watch
I just remember it being very like, hey, remember when we did this in a previous season when the show was better? Hey, remember when we did this? Like, it was very self-referential in a way that's like, our heart and soul is gone, so we're going to try and, like, trick you into remembering better times.
They try to bring paintball back, and it's garbage, and then they bring it back in the sixth season, and it's really good.
Yeah.
Like, how they bring it back in the sixth season is, like, I feel like they just... I feel like people shit on the last two seasons too, and I fucking love the last two seasons. I think they're
I remember I never finished three. I never actually finished the show.
Oh, I'm sorry. Oh,
you still haven't?
No. Oh, but really? I mean, I watched it. I watched a decent amount of, I think I watched all of season 5. I just remember I remember being bummed that like all the main cast was leaving, like
but only one of those was a real bummer because
You lose
Shirley and Pearson. That's okay.
Yeah.
They both have some good moments.
But yeah.
I still think
I'm super okay.
It's December 12th. That's
yeah.
I think Pierce 10th. I think Pierce was a pretty big hit. I think like if he wasn't a piece of shit outside of the show, I would be like more upset that he left. But he is, there's some episodes with him that are really fucking funny.
But the best Pierce centric episode in the entire series is the one where he's
dead
and not in it. It's the eulogy episode from season 5. That's the hands down best Pierce centric episode.
The Dungeons & Dragons one is really good too.
Are you talking about season 2?
Yeah.
I do not like those episodes. It's because it's 2 episodes, right?
No, it's 1.
It's just 1. They redo it later on, and that one's okay. I hate the way that they make him the villain in season 2. Like, I'm okay with having like an asshole character, but like, it's not fun, him just making fun of Fat Neil. It's so cruel and unfunny that just like, I don't like it.
Okay.
And I don't like this him like cheating the game to like win shit over on the others. It's like, it's not entertaining. Like, that's like, a lot of people say season 2 is like the best because it has,
I think, certain episodes too.
But of like the good seasons, it has some really great episodes, but it might be my least favorite because it has the D&D episode, it has the Claymation Christmas,
and there's maybe like one or two those are like the lowest, but there's like maybe a couple other that are just like whatever episodes. Man, to me
that's I feel like that whole there hasn't been an episode that I've seen that I'm like out of season two, because we're in like three quarters of the way through season two, and yeah, every episode has just hit like so hard. Like the premiere for season two is great. Yeah, the Halloween episode, I like the Christmas episode. Yeah. The drug awareness episode is really good.
Yeah, that one is good. Yeah,
there is that when Betty White starts showing up.
No, that she's in the first episode of season two.
Well, yeah, okay. Season two is when she. Yeah,
and then
yeah, she's
like in and out that whole season.
Abed as Jesus is really funny.
Yeah, there's a lot of good stuff. And then it's still really good season of television.
The second paintball is good.
Except for season four, the worst paintball in my opinion.
Season four.
Except for season four, season two's paintball is the worst paintball in my opinion. We got to get out of this rabbit hole.
Yeah,
compare every single episode of Community against each other.
I think I will say this one thing just on that. Okay. I think that the reason I would say it's probably my favorite one.
Of paintball?
Yeah, that or season five. It's just I've noticed rewatching it that there are some. That's fine. It's fine if you disagree with me. I'm just saying why. Something I've noticed with Community is that I just said I enjoy that they're like really tight, short episodes, but I wish that it was made like today where they, you know, one episode would be 25 minutes, one episode would be 30 minutes, one episode would be, you know, whatever.
You like that that's a longer story.
I like that it's a longer, and I feel like the first paintball is like, I want it to be fleshed out so much more, and it's just like, people will come in and then they die right away, or they get eliminated and they get taken out. I will say the finale for that, like with Chang and the his machine gun, and then he like opens his, like that shit is all great. But yeah, I like how the second one is like fleshed out, and then it goes Western to Star Wars. Like I really like that transition. But yeah,
I think it's more impressive that they are able to fit that stuff into a shorter thing. Okay, let's go. Nick, did you have anything else to say? Where are we going at?
Oh, I mean, I was on the only other thing I was going to bring up was maybe what we do in the shadows, because I really like it. But I
wondered if you were going to.
I don't know. I gaslit myself into thinking that you also said that you liked that show. So like when I messaged you,
I love the movie.
When I messaged you, I was like, damn, this show is so good. And then you're like, oh, I don't like the show. I was like, oh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's too long of a discussion for right now.
Travis.
Okay.
I think Travis likes it, though.
Yeah, he does. He really likes it.
I've started it, but I didn't get into it.
So, I like Matt Berry. Matt Berry's great.
I love Matt Berry. I wish he wasn't imitating Jemaine Clement from the movie, you know?
Is that what it is?
Okay, in short, a big reason is, it feels like they're just copying the movie characters, but I like the movie characters a lot more. So
wait,
that's a shorthand like starter packet for my complaints for that show.
The guy from IT Crowd,
yeah,
he copies Dennis,
Douglas Rhodum
from
Jimmy
Flight of the Conchords.
Yeah.
Dixon Bainbridge.
Yeah. Vladislav the Boker.
Yeah, he's so good. Yeah, that movie.
Yeah, Matt Berry's great. I love him in like pretty much everything. He's I don't dislike him, I guess, in that show, but it would be nice if
there somebody that was gonna do an American adaptation of the IT Crowd, and somebody was cast as
Chris O'Dowd.
Yeah,
it was Joel McHale.
Okay, yeah. that's why I was thinking, and that would have been bad.
Are we doing a cup pull, or you already in?
Yeah. So okay. So next week's episode, is our dud movie, which I guess slight spoilers coming up because we already recorded this episode. So along with this movie announcement, I'm issuing a challenge. The movie is Alone in the Dark from 2005, directed by Uwe Boll.
And the challenge is for the director, Dr. Bull, your movie sucks shit, and I'm willing to stake my claim in the boxing ring. This is not a joke, if this gets to you. And you feel so inclined to reach out, I will list our social pages in a little bit. You feel free to contact us there. And I will throw down in the octagon, you old German bitch, because your movie sucks ass. With that, if you don't want to be spoiled for Alone in the Dark, it's on Tubi. But in this case, Tubi don't show booby, so you might want to rent it somewhere else. No, you don't. Don't pay for this movie.
No, we already looked it up. The Tara Reid sex scene, you don't even see booby, so it's not even worth it.
Cut it. Yeah.
It's, I know. Too hot for TV.
For Tubi. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we'll watch it there if you don't want to be spoiled for this great, great movie. We also have socials on this is for you, Uva Ball, on TikTok, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. We don't get much, and by much I mean any chatter. So again, Dr. Bull, we will see your message when it comes through.
eagerly anticipating it.
So I'll be waiting for it. All right. Well, that shit's out of the way. I am your. Oh, you know what? Here, we'll do this. We'll do this. And I am your pre-milk truck just arriving Christopher Walken. And I talk like this. TJ, aka J Spot Jack Cheese, with me as always.
As always, I am your your scumbag baby wielding politician, Nick, aka Dr. Funk on Twitch, and with me as always.
As always, sometimes as the kids that drowned in the lake when the ice break.
And that ice was gonna break.
Zay Big, Islea, never not shitting.
All right. See you later.
Goodbye.